Our goal for today is to continue looking at when do series converge. And in particular, we're going to do something a little different, which is allow for minuses. So far, all of our tests involve us the assumption that, hey, we're going to add things which are positive or maybe at least non-negative, right? But now, maybe we could add, then subtract, and add, then subtract, add, subtract. We're going to call this an alternating series, where we alternate between addition and subtraction. And we're going to ask the question, when do such things converge? And there's going to be a really beautiful answer. It's going to be like, ah! And for a lot of people, it's their favorite test. So that means we're going to have a lot of fun today. Well, let's begin. So here we go. Let's just say what's happening. Suppose we have some terms where the a sub n is positive and they decrease to zero. Okay, so we have terms which are shrinking down to zero. Then the conclusion is that when we add up the sum of negative 1 to the n, a sub n, that converges. This is amazing, right? Because think about how simple. We're just saying we need to have two things happen. The terms have to go to zero, right? So the terms, as you go increasing for n, get smaller and smaller. And they have to alternate sign. Plus, minus, plus, minus, plus, minus. And that's it. So normally when we talk about convergence, it's like, well, okay, we're going to zero, but you know, how quickly are we going to zero? And for us, we're like, yeah, we don't care about that anymore. As long as we go to zero, it's enough. So it's kind of surprising how simple this test is. So what's the idea? Why does it work? Well, here's sort of the basic philosophy. So we can imagine we start at some value. So you can imagine, look, this is our first term, and then we subtract. Okay, so maybe, well, let's just say this is like our a0. Here, when we subtract, we'll have a0 minus a1. And then, right, because we subtract, we go to the left. Add, we go to the right. When we add, we're going to come back here. So a0 minus a1 plus a2. Now, here's the important thing. If we think about every other term, so if I'm here, a0, then the next term will shoot way over there, but then I go back. So boom, boom. What will happen? Well, what will happen is I'm going to have to be going to the left. So every other term goes to the left. But I can do the same thing over there, right? Because what happens here? If I now go to my next term, which is here, that's a0 minus a1 plus a2 minus a3. And now, look, the net effect, because we added a larger number than we subtracted, we're going to be moving to the right. So these points are moving to the left, going down. Over here, we're moving to the right. And so we're just hopping back and forth. But the other thing is, how far are we hopping? The amount that we hop is the nth term. It's going to zero. And therefore, we're going to hop back and forth and eventually circle in to our limit. So that's how it works. It becomes really monotone convergence theorem in the end. Is because you have this sort of nice behavior every other term. Every other term you either are going up, every other term are going down, and then life works out beautifully. So, very simple test. Just remember two things to check. Do you go to zero? Do you alternate? You converge. Wow, cool. Now, of course, this raises some questions. Okay, what about the type of convergence? Now, what do you mean? Well, suppose we have a series, a sub n. There are some possibilities. Well, one possibility says, look, you don't need to have the plus or minus. So when we talk about the absolute value of a sub n, that's something which is absolutely convergent, right? So if this sum, when we take the absolute value, converges, it's absolutely convergent. In that case, it says, look, you don't need plus or minus. It doesn't matter. But maybe you do. Now, what's an example? So first off, we should give examples. If you look at the sum from, say, 1 to infinity of minus 1 to the n over n squared, absolutely convergent. Why? Because the minus 1 to the n doesn't really do anything. Because the sum of 1 over n squared, that's a p series, that converges. Now, by comparison, we say something is conditionally convergent if the sum a sub n converges, but the sum of the abs value of a sub n diverges. In other words, you need the minus. If you don't have that minus sign, it ruins it. We also have examples of this. So think about it this way. We know that the sum of minus 1 to the n over n, well, that will converge. Why? Alternating series test. That minus 1 to the n makes it alternate. The 1 over n goes to 0. But if we take away the minus 1 to the n, then we get just the sum of 1 over n. Forget it. That'll diverge. So conditionally convergent says, ooh, pay attention. You need to have some extra stuff involved, which leads to some interesting things we're going to talk about in just a minute here. So we have the series is convergent, the series is conditionally convergent, absolutely convergent, conditionally convergent, and then just plain old diverges. So an example of this, sum 1 to infinity of just 1 over n, because we can have things which diverge. Or maybe a better example, look, sum n equals 1 to infinity of minus 1 to the n times n. Okay, well, minus 1, plus 2, minus 3, plus 4, so forth. No, can't converge. Terms get too large. Even though you're alternating sign, terms don't go to 0. And so, there you go. There's examples. Now, one thing you should observe is, hey, if you're absolutely convergent, so in other words, you don't need the plus minus, then you also converge without the extra plus minus thrown in. So being absolutely convergent is a very strong statement. It says, look, we really don't need any extra help. The conditionally convergent says, ooh, I could really use some extra help if you're offering it to me. So why do we sort of distinguish between these? Well, it's important to understand that conditionally convergent is sort of kind of strange. And we'll make that very clear. So here we go. If our sum is absolutely convergent, then it doesn't matter which order we add things in. In other words, we can scramble the order of our terms up in any way we like. We're still going to get the same value at the end. So we still add up the same infinite numbers any particular way that we like, same output. Okay, this agrees with what we think should be true. We're like, yeah, of course, come on, don't be silly. It should never matter how we add numbers. But, this is the fun part, if we're conditionally convergent, then by rearranging the way that we add things, it can change the output. And in fact, it gets even stranger than that. Not only can we change the output, in other words, change the value of what we get at the end, we can make the value be literally any number that we want. And so that's why conditionally convergent is really, really weird, because it sort of breaks our way of thinking about addition. Let's see if we can understand that. So we're going to start with a really simple idea. Look at the alternating sum, but it's attached to the harmonic series. So, you know, instead of 1 plus a half plus a third plus a fourth, then, you know, now it's every other term you subtract. 1 minus a half plus a third minus a fourth plus a fifth, so forth and so on. And if you go and look this up, and with good justifiable reason, it is log of 2. Now, this doesn't make any sense right now, but it will in the near future. We'll say, like, oh, yeah. That's why. But for now, let's just say, okay, it's if we add it up in this particular order, all right, that's what we get. Now, what happens? Well, here's the idea. If you're conditionally convergent, what really must happen is when you look at the plus terms, you have to have a lot of them. And when you look at the minus terms, you have to have a lot of them. And in particular, what ends up happening is if you say, okay, so let's suppose we're conditionally convergent, then what we have is when you put all the positive terms together, and you just add just the positive terms, you'll get to infinity. Whereas if you add all the negative terms together, well, you'll get to minus infinity. So in other words, when you have a conditional convergence, what you actually secretly have is an infinity minus infinity. Okay. Well, what's true about infinity minus infinity? The answer is it's indeterminate. In other words, it's not able to be determined from just that expression. And it's that ambiguity that allows us to say, oh, we can rearrange. How does it work? Well, imagine that you sort of have the following. You have two very long chains. So let's go with these numbers here. So you have a 1 plus a 1 comma, a 1 third, a 1 fifth, a 1 seventh, a 1 ninth, so forth and so on. So you list all of your even terms, okay, and in this case, all of your odd terms, and then you have minus a half, minus a fourth, minus a sixth, minus an eighth, and so forth, and so on. Now, so these are your two lists, and suppose we have a goal. Let's suppose we want to get it to pi, right? What could be simpler? Easy as pi. So, what do you say? Well, what we do is we say we'll start at 0, and then we start using these terms. So we do 1, a third, a fifth, and so forth and so on. So that's just going to keep marching us up. And it'll march us up slowly over time, and eventually we'll have some place where we just pass pi. Okay, so it might be way, 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 way down here. I don't know, 1 over 1,001. Who knows? Okay, as soon as you pass pi, what do you do? You say, whoop, went too far. Then go backward one step. So now minus a half. Okay, and now what do you do? Well, okay, now keep marching forward with the positives. All right, now it's very small, hard to make progress. But eventually, because there's infinitely many things, the result is infinite when you add them together, you're going to get past it at some point. You're like, oh, okay, I passed it again. Now I'll go back by a fourth. All right, so it's a pretty big jump back. Even though it takes you a lot of terms to get past pi, we're just going to take one step back. Okay, now repeat. Now you have to do lots and lots and lots and lots of steps, but eventually you'll get past pi again, and then what do? Then you go to your next term. And you go back by just 1/6, right? And so what you're doing is you say, look, really what's happening, another way to see it, is when you have something which is conditionally convergent, if you think about the number line, you're going to take a lot of movement to the right. You're going to move infinitely often to the right. You're going to move infinitely often to the left. And so you can say, look, keep moving to the right until you pass that point. Move a little bit to the left, and then keep moving to the right again, move a little bit to the left, and then just sort of keep doing that. At the end, you'll have moved infinitely often in both directions, but you'll be sort of moving around this sort of desired point, in our case, pi. And so that's why you get this sort of strange phenomenon going on. So that's why we somehow like to distinguish. Absolutely convergent is much stronger than conditionally convergent, because it does what we think it should do. It really says, oh, you can break things up in natural ways. You can rearrange. Life is good. So that's why there is a distinction. Well, all right. Good. Well, that's mostly just a fun fact at the end. Main takeaway for today, alternating series test is really cool. You know, look for something that alternates plus, minus, plus, minus, plus, minus. Terms go down to zero. Life is good. And we're ready to go and do some more problems. All right. Hope to see you soon. Bye.